Hey, what's up, YouTube? Welcome to Play Opinion Live. Time for another live stream. Time to fire it up. I don't know. Bored. We'll paint for a little bit here, and I've got to get you guys caught up on what we've been working on. So thanks in advance for tuning in. We'll see how long this goes. Again, it's a Sunday night. If I'm being honest with you, I'm fairly tired, and you know, getting ready for the work week tomorrow. But that said, a little bit of painting, and I'm super bored. But let me get you guys caught up on where we are. So last time, we looked at the Alchemist team, and I think I was still in like blocking out the major colors, and I got super tired doing that. But the rest of the week. Weekend, I went ahead and finished, or at least got them to, I don't know if it's finished, but I got them to a point where I'm reasonably happy with them. So let's go have a look at the Alchemist Guild. So, you know, starting here with Flask, and I'm going to put these away as I go, actually. See if I can put them someplace safer than there. Got all this stuff on the ledge of my table behind me. No, let's try to just do something here. Okay, so there was Flask. The mascots, the Alchemist mascots are fairly unimpressive. So Flask, and then you've got Nadja, who's pretty cool. But again, you know, nothing really to write home about there. Got a guild ball. No one cares about that. And then let's start looking at the proper teammates here. Starting with this guy here. Here is Midas. I'm not sure if I'm done with his fists, but I'm leaving it like that right now. I don't know. It probably needs a little more depth to it. I should probably actually wash it or something. But as for right now, it's okay. Actually, maybe it needs a little orange. We'll see. But he looks okay. So Midas, who is, you know, I'm probably going to play this team for a game or so before I put it on eBay. Just one of my favorite sculpts in the entire Guild Ball range. And this is Calculus. I always have fun. There's always one that's super fun in every team. For the Alchemist, it's this lady right here, Calculus. I have so much fun painting her. She's a really cool looking mini. A lot of character in the face. Also really neat character in the fluff. So I'm a fan there. Here is Compound, a really cool miniature. You can see I need to do another coat here on the base. But yeah, Compound, super fun. Again, he's one of the more interesting miniatures because he has a lot going on. He's got wood, flesh, cloth, liquid. I would probably say he's one of the more challenging in the entire Guild Ball range. But anyways, yeah, Compound, super fun. Here is Mercury. Like the mustachioed bad guy, which is kind of cool. Sometimes I do that flame, like blue, like it's like propane fuel, but sometimes I do it red. Here's someone you don't get to see more very often. This is Crucible. Wow, she is a really interesting miniature. So I had a lot of fun painting her. Because she's got, in the art, she kind of has this, like, this cocoa-colored skin, and then she has really light hair. So she reminds me of Storm from X-Men. But just such a cool, very cool model. Had a lot of fun with her. You got Smoke. Smoke is interesting because I'm not I'm still not even sure if I like the model, if I'm being totally honest with you. I don't know if I like the idea of this model being kind of one piece wrapped in a cloud like that. But I'm not entirely sure. I didn't even realize that there's actually another symbol there we paint in. But she's kind of cool. I think the problem I have with her is if you look at her face is pretty, you know, compared to a lot of the other Guild Ball faces, that's one of the weaker ones. And I'll show you, like, there's a lot of character in Guild Ball faces, which is part of the reason why I have so much fun painting it. Like, case in point, here we go with, here's Venin. It's a miniature I don't even really care for. But, you know, he's got character in his eyes. Like, he's really static pose, but again, super fun. So there's Venin. Got a few left. Here's Catalyst 1. Kind of a boring. I love the pose, though. Oh, I got it. Yeah. So, Catalyst 1, pretty cool. Vitriol, one of my favorite miniatures in the whole line. Just kind of an awkward pose. So I really like Vitriol, one of my favorite miniatures. Also, super fun in game. She's like basically a mainstay of any Alchemist team I would run. She's just super reliable. She's a good striker and actually a fairly reliable damage dealer when it comes down to it. So she's a main parts of the attack. I really like to run her and Calculus as kind of the pin there. And then finally, this guy was super fun to paint. Got Labyrinth minis and I got the sniffles. Yeah, I got the sniffles. This is Veteran Catalyst. And wow, like, I don't know if your screen is showing this, but the kind of skin tone stuff I did on this model was crazy and super fun. You can see there's lots of greens and blues and violets and all kinds of stuff. You know, the idea with Veteran Catalyst is that he's got pumped up so full of chemicals, and he's got burns, he's got boils and blisters, he's got maybe areas where his skin is starting to rot. Super fun. I had no interest in this model at all for the longest time, like no interest in buying this model, playing. I think this is like a $45 model or something crazy like that. It's worth it. I mean, this is one of those models that you can murder a living person with because of the metal that the model is. But look at that, like so much fun. Anyway, so that's the just on that Alchemist team. I have a couple of minor things left to do on them, but you'll see them soon enough on eBay. I'm gonna put them up for sale. I want to play at least a game or two. We'll see. I'd love to play a game with them, but I don't know. My time, the way it is, I don't know how often or like if I'm gonna get that chance. Anyway, so that project is done. Like I said, I'll keep them around for a little bit, maybe try to play a game with them, and then we'll go from there. Okay, so the other day, I was at the LGS Comic Quest, and I saw Labyrinth, the board game, on the shelf. Okay? Now let's get a couple things out of the way. One, yes, I do love Labyrinth. I'm a fan of the show, of the movie. It's one of my favorite movies growing up because Labyrinth came out when I was, I think, in fifth grade, and I was actually playing D&D at the time, that Labyrinth came out. And if you were playing D&D back that time, like, you were getting clowned to no end, right? I know I keep bringing this up on the show a lot, but, like, you guys have to, younger guys have to consider the idea that you guys, you call it nerd stuff right now. You call this fandom, nerd, geekdom and nerddom. But you guys don't know, like, you guys have not been through the kind of ridicule and stigma that us older guys have. So you're welcome. So it's just my old man, my inner old man talking to you about Labyrinth and, you know, why we're cooler than you and all this other stuff. But anyways, let's have a look at the miniatures. Okay. So the Labyrinth game comes with five, miniatures, but, look, and they're quite a bit taller. Like, here's a, let me show you, I just had a mini for, here we go. So here's a standard, millimeter miniature. There's a calculus, and here is, Jareth. So you can see they're significantly bigger than, you know, your regular 30 millimeter, miniature. So Jareth, the Goblin King, and here's the thing, they're okay sculpts. They're okay sculpts. It's kind of hard to say, like, could they have really done better with these? Because you're thinking, like, they're really taking these off, you know, actors in costumes. So they don't have the ability or nor really the desire to exaggerate features the way you normally see on miniatures. So it's a lot of soft lines, a lot of, you know, softer edges on the miniatures, but not, there's not a like the level of detail isn't great. It's not great, but it might do. I don't know. I honestly won't know until we start painting these. I don't know if they're going to be okay or not. He's got the like rolling crystal ball thing here. He's got the skeleton on his back. I need to decide painting these. I need to decide like, how realistic I want to be. Do I want to try to make it look like, you know, you're really looking at the actors or in this case, the puppets in play here. I sir something. I forget this one's name. He's basically a dog riding another dog. He's a terrier riding a sheepdog, essentially. So you got that guy. This is, you know, probably my least favorite miniature. And I do wish that, okay, if we're going to talk about level of detail, I do wish that the hair feature was a little more prominent, so it'd make it easier for me to catch edges and that things like that. The other issue is if you look down his face, see that giant running square down the middle of his face. I tried to knock some of it off with the hobby knife, but it's really prominent. So I don't really know what I'm going to do there. Then you got, who's actually pretty, that's actually pretty good sculpt. Like that's a pretty good sculpt. Sir Didymus. Thank you. That's a pretty good Hoggle sculpt. Like that's actually spot on. That's the level of detail I think I would come to expect and the size. Then you have Ludo, the great miniature. Ludo is actually, he's actually my favorite miniature in this whole set because he's a fairly simple paint job, but he's really cool. One other issue I will have with this is if you look at the way they did the basing, really good way to get them off the base. So if I wanted to do a scenic base, it's off the table. I cannot do that with these miniatures. So that said, look at the character on Ludo is just fantastic. They did a great job on Ludo. And finally, you got Sarah here. and Sarah is, you know, hey, I'm just going to tell you guys, like, again, imagine me in fifth grade playing D&D, being hated by all of society and being told you're a devil worshiper and all this other stuff, which is, by the way, not very different from what it is now with, you know, all of the cool guys writing articles about how horrible it is, how horribly oppressive it is to be in the tabletop gaming world. Anyway, bullshit. Anyway, here's Sarah, and we'll see how she does. She was really cool though, because like I said, I was in the fifth grade when this movie came out, and you had, you know, was close to my age, actually maybe a little bit older, in the movie Labyrinth. And she plays D&D, like, but even maybe even a little sadder than me, like she plays D&D alone, and she like dresses up and goes to the park and plays D&D, and then, you know, then she has to remember to go home and watch her little brother. And anyways, you guys know the movie, but it was kind of cool. Like for me, it was kind of cool that people that, you know, you had this character that you could sort of identify with, that, you know, that somebody making the movie actually knew, you know, at least the most rudimentary thing about D&D and turned it into a feature film. Like, that's cool. Like, when we were, like I said, like, that's progress. These days, man, you can play, yeah, Toby's little brother. Like, D&D in the coffee shop. And people go, wow, you're so edgy playing D&D in a coffee shop. It wasn't like that back then, okay? It wasn't like that back then. If you said, hey, I'm playing Dungeons and Dragons back then, people would go, what the fuck is the matter with you? Anyway, so those are the Labyrinth miniatures. I tried to do a little prep on them, but we're just going to, tonight, really, we're just going to spray them. I'm going to see if there's any color blocking that we can do. Probably Ludo we could do color blocking on, but not many other miniatures. Okay, so anyways, real relaxing evening. We're not going to go at a frantic pace. We're going to talk about whatever the hell you guys want to talk about. And if you guys aren't going to talk about anything, well, you're going to have to deal with my torturous choice of topics, which is always rather interesting. Okay, so I bought an airbrush that's actually cheaper than the Masters G233, and I don't know if it's any good. Seems like that 0.3 needle is staying intact, though. Anyway, what's up, Blade Wolf? So if you're just joining the show, welcome to Play It Painted Live. Let us know what you're painting or what you should be painting. In front of you are the miniatures for Labyrinth, the board game. Heard nothing but bad things about the board game. Nothing but bad things about the board game. As a game, you know, considered on its own merit, they're saying it's not a very good game. I probably am never going to find out, because if I'm being honest with you guys, my goal here is to paint these miniatures and then just turn around and sell it. And just sell it to a collector or somebody. It's like, you can get Labyrinth the board game with painted pieces. And, you know, if you like it, cool. If not. All right. Definitely feel like I've got a leak here. Like, this airbrush, the seals on this airbrush are not very good, it seems. Cannot get it to seal up. All right. Let's get some gloves on. So, as of right now, commission land is wide open. I don't have any commissions going. I'm glad I was able to finish that Alchemist team, because I'll be able to eBay that. Although I'm a little worried, because the cost of that team a fairly high price for it on eBay. But we'll see. Wow. It's really not holding pressure. You hear that? You hear it just keep constantly kicking on, right? I don't know what I can do. It just, maybe this airbrush has really, really cheap seals. Yeah, this airbrush does have really cheap seals. Okay. You hear my nose more often than the compressor. You hear that? It just keeps going. Whatever. Let's just do the airbrush here. Yeah, sorry about the sniffle. I did contract a little bit of a bug over this past weekend. So let's get these going. Okay. Too much fun at knots. I think I got it the day before, actually, when we went to we did all this Easter stuff, egg hunts and all that kind of stuff. Do hoggle. Can get Comic-Con badges? No, I didn't even try because I was doing other things. Sorry about that. I'm pretty sure I'm not going to get invited to work Comic-Con this year. That's a bit of a bummer. Although, I think I've admitted that I'm fairly over Comic-Con. Last but not least, your Ludo. I gotta figure out this leak. It's really bad. All right, let's let that dry for a minute. My mother's boyfriend, I tried telling people to go to WonderCon. Yeah, WonderCon's fine. My mother's boyfriend wanted to give me tickets, so he sent me money to purchase. How nice. That was nice of him. All right, here we go. Gonna go to WonderCon and sick that week. All right. Okay. So with the quick disconnect out, you hear that there's no issue. So the leak is clearly on the airbrush side. I wonder if I switch airbrushes, if I put the old guy in. Aiming to go to Comic-Con Revolution, Ontario. It's a new one. Cool. Oh, whoa, okay. I think I found our problem. Look at that. So there's an O-ring that sits on the bottom of this. Let me show you. There's an O-ring that sits on the bottom of this quick disconnect, which is all kinds of messed up right now. So let's see. Let's put that in there. Got our little bit of tweezers, seat properly. And then I'm just gonna put a little drop of water in there to help it seal. Okay. All right. And then now let's try it. Let's see if it's only a one-day event, $25. Not bad. It doesn't sound bad, at least. No, still got. All right, still got issues there. Let's try. Let's try the old airbrush and see if it still has the same issue. You can see this guy's been through battles. This is the G233. There's a slight leak. No, it's about the same amount of leak in there. Okay. So yeah. All right. So it's a good thing we didn't plan to do much tonight, because gonna do a little bit of troubleshooting here. All right. Let's see. Oh, isn't that interesting? Well, look at this. See, there is. That's actually a. It's supposed to rise above the ring there. And you have this O-ring that sits right there. Let's replace this O-ring. Maybe the O-ring, well, I'm sure the O-ring actually is the issue. Let's replace it with this O-ring. Okay, so I'm going to pop that O-ring in there, right? And close that bad boy and hope that forms a good seal. Might buy some more monies with the money he sent me. Is that wrong? I think he has a right to know that he didn't get Comic-Con tickets. Look at that. That immediately fixed it. I will just congratulate myself on yet another successful airbrush repair. Yeah, I don't know. I think he has a right to know. Like, if you're, if you ended up doing something else with the money and you told them, hey, you know, I didn't get into Comic-Con, but I've got these Comic-Con Revolution badge. I got a Comic-Con Revolution badge and I still have some money left over. I don't know the nuances of your specific situation, but that's the honorable side of me talking, that if somebody gifted me money to do something, that I would feel obliged to tell them that that I'm going to spend their money on something else. So yeah, I don't know. That's just my two cents. All right. Let's do a little gray in here. So why do I still do black if I don't really care to have a Xenothal Prime? Well, the reason why is because that black gloss sticks really well. Getting a fair bit of spitting here. Yeah, take it for what it's worth. I mean, I don't know. Let's deal with, you know, if people gift me stuff, I let them know. The counter argument to that, though, is that people don't gift me with stuff usually. I usually don't get gifts like that. So that's a pretty damn awesome gift. All right. It's funny that this 0.3 needle is not doing a very good job handling the gray primer. It isn't. It's just overshooting it. It's wild. I may have the pressure up way too high. This thing is delivering a crazy amount of primer through there. See how that, like, it's running out super fast and it shouldn't be. It's just, it's putting out so much. Prime, I need to deliver color more slowly than that. More gradually, but it's just dumping the whole. It just dumps all the gray primer down. All right, and then we're gonna do Ludo. My gray, looks like my gray primer also getting too thick. There's so much gray primer on here. I don't even know if I need the white on there. Like, there's a giant puddle of gray primer there. Looks like my pressure is a little high. I'll go fix that. And while we're doing that, let me look at. Yeah, I think the way this is coming out of the gun, I think at best I would be able to color block Ludo, but I don't see anybody else really getting much treatment from the airbrush here. So we may be in for a very short feed. Because what I don't want to do with how soft this plastic is, I do not want to take a brush stuff tonight. I don't think it's going to end well if I did that. What up? What up, Gotta? I guess I should follow up. It's a little bit of white. And then let me look at some stock photos of Labyrinth stuff. If they have pictures of Ludo, that's a great picture of most of the cast. Okay, so Ludo looks pretty much like an orangutan. If I'm going to do Hoggle is, he's got like a cream color as most of his outfit. I could do that. And then what about Sarah? Labyrinth. Let's see. Let's look at Jennifer Connelly's outfit. She also has that kind of cream color. She's got like cream color, and then she has this really kind of annoying vest and jeans. Yeah. So actually, I could color block. What about Jareth? I like how the next thing on the search here is Jennifer Connelly's body. That's a great... what I miss. Yeah, we're doing some Labyrinth. Yeah, Jennifer Connelly body is the next thing here. Let's see... Okay, Ludo. Let's look at Jareth's primary outfit. He also kind of has a cream undertone, so maybe if I did that, I could. You know what? It looks like, other than Ludo, I should be able to do a cream undertone on all of them. Didymus has kind of a cream undertone for him, too. So let's pick some colors here. And see what we got. Cream color Jennifer Connelly. Yeah, you know what? That's funny. Yeah. If that offends any of my viewers, well, you haven't been watching this show much, have I? Let me just tell you right now. And I say this all the time. I will never apologize for being attracted to specific things. I will just never apologize for that. Never apologize for being a straight man that likes him from Jennifer Connelly. Okay? Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead. If you're going to be outraged about that, go right ahead. Sorry. Never going to apologize. Sorry, not sorry. Never going to apologize for it. As Ralph Tresvant said in the song Cool It Now, if I like the girl, who cares who you like? That's right. I just quoted Cool It Now on my stream. Can you deal with that is the question. Okay, that's... I don't need... I need a kind of a medium. I need to shade this properly. If I'm going to do that cream undertone... Maybe that's not bad. It almost needs just a hair darker than that. And just, it just seems like when you go too dark, like this might have too much red in it. That actually might be a good highlight for Ludo, not so much for the other bits. So for Ludo, I'm gonna need almost like this like ruddy color, and then like that might be more of a Ludo tone. Ludo almost has like a red orange color. 800815. I don't even know what I'm not sure what you're talking about there, Tori, but yeah. That's right. That's right, world. Deal with it. I like, I like the ladies. I like certain ones too. Like, I like some more than others. You can't really, yeah. And I'm not going to, like I said, I'm not going to apologize for it. Look at that. You got a little bit of bounce there. See that? Primer? Didn't quite stick, which is why we did the gloss black. Because the gloss black sticks better than the other primer I've got on hand. I don't know why my paper is stuck to the paper. I'm going to turn it around here so that we can get those colors down, okay? So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to spray this down as the undercoat, and then this is going to be like the mid coat for all those cream colors that need to go down. Okay. Oh, you were doing boobies on the calculator thing. Oh, gotcha. Okay. All right. So I'm in a 0.3 needle, so I can't really do, very good detail here. It's pretty much going to hit the entire model. But that's okay. The one advantage to the 0.3 needle, though, is I can make a bigger batch of paint in the confident it's not going to get ruined. All right, here we go. So we're going to spray this down. Okay, and this is going to look too brown, and I get that, but it's going to be, it's really the undercoat for what will be the rest of the model, okay? So you see, you just kind of build it slow like that. I don't think Jareth's cloak is this color. Okay. And here we go with Sarah. My wife gets a little creeped out when I tell her how fondly I recall, a young Jennifer Connelly watching this movie. She's like, "Well, you're an old guy. She was underage back then." I'm like, "Yeah, but I was in fifth grade when this came out. She was older than me." See the logic? But yeah. And she doesn't, for the record, she doesn't really understand the appeal behind Jennifer Connelly. She's like, "Every guy I've ever gone out with loves Jennifer Connelly, and I don't get it." I'm like, "Yeah, you don't. You don't have to get it. It's okay." I, for one, am grateful that I can, these things rationally with my wife. No, she doesn't get why so many of us love Jennifer Connelly. But I don't have to. So these, oh, no, Sir Jareth. Sir Didymus. You know what? I might as well just get the whole. Just do all of Jareth this way. Might as well. Really, no downside to doing this. Since I got it all in my airbrush anyway. It's the eyebrows? That's the thing. Okay. When I was also at the same time, I was in the fifth grade, right? I had my first, you know, quote unquote girlfriend in the fifth grade. Her name was Jill, and she was actually almost 2 years older than me. Right. She was an Air Force brat, and her, moved them around quite a bit. So she was a little behind in school. So she was a little older than the rest of us. And, you know, so we were in fifth grade and she was, we'll just say she was a little mature for her age. And, you know, and she was my girlfriend. And, my older brother, was, let's see, if I was in fifth grade, he was 16 at the time. Yeah, he was 16 at the time. And his friends, those like high school friends, would come over and they would, you know, they would see me with my girlfriend and they'd see pictures of her and they'd be like, wow, your girlfriend's mature, man. They're like, yeah, good job. Anyways, the reason why I bring her up is she had eyebrows like, at that age, and she had long, long dark hair like that. And yeah, she was, yeah. Anyway, yeah. So anyway, that's the kind of effect Labyrinth had on my life. So now that we got that out in the open, we can move along here. I'm going to give Ludo here a spray. I think I'm going to go with mud brown instead of rust. Rust seems a little too red. I don't know. Actually, rust is probably okay. Let's go rust. Let's see what we can do. You're 9 when Labyrinth came out. Yeah. Yeah, I think I was fifth grade, I think. Fifth or sixth grade. What? Hold on. This right now. What year did Labyrinth come out? Labyrinth, 1986. Okay, I was in sixth grade. Yeah. But that, you know, still had my little girlfriend, Jill. And still remember those days quite fondly. So, anyway, let's try rust. I wonder if I'm going to thin it just in case. I don't want to have deal with leaks tonight. But I won't thin it that much. It is Vallejo air, so shouldn't have to thin it too much. So sixth grade when it came out, I just remember watching her play D&D in the beginning, and that was like one of my favorite things about the movie was that you know, it was a story about a pretty girl who plays D&D and has no friends, and you're like, in the 80s, you were like, sure, that can happen. You didn't realize, especially younger kids. At the time, you don't really realize that the world is a different place for pretty girls, you know? I have to constantly remind my wife that. I'm like, the world was a different place for you growing up. You were a pretty girl, and I was not. I was a weird, foreign-looking kid, you know? So the world treated me much differently than that. Actually, that doesn't look too bad. I know it looks super shiny on camera because it's wet, but that's actually a pretty good undercoat color for Ludo here. Okay, I'm going to let that dry. Hey, we're 10. Bunch of geezers on here. Yeah. Here's something really sad. When I bought the game at the store, the girl who rang me out and her friend looked at me like I was like just decrepit. I was like, yeah, you know, you remember the movie Labyrinth? It's cool. And I'm going to buy it and paint it because, you know, nostalgia, and I'll probably just sell it. And they're like, what's Labyrinth? I was like, you haven't seen Labyrinth? And they're like, yeah, kind of. You know, it was on my feed once, and I kind of recall. And you're like, man, not no Labyrinth. Anyway, the tough call. Tough call here. I think I want this color. It's sad, isn't it? It's sad. The youth of today, I look at their, you know, they talk about, oh, the, you know, New 52 and all this other stuff. And comic books are so politically active and all this other crap. And I'm like, that's not new, you guys. It's not new. It's just the difference between politically active comics then and now is that back then they would do politically active or socially conscious comics, but they made sure that they were written properly. You know, they made sure they still had good stories and interesting characters. Anyway, see, you don't want, this is what happens when I choose the topic, you guys. This is bad. Zenithal Prime on the Hoggle here. You can see that's kind of the color. Like, see that cream color? That's kind of his color. We'll hit it with a lighter color, like a bone color to highlight. Everything's unfair. It's weird when you talk about warriors and they're like, what? And I put my 7-9-year-old into Labyrinth and Princess Bride. Warriors is awesome. I love Warriors. I'll just be honest with you guys, though. When I was a kid, I only got to watch Warriors like once. I watched it again later in life and loved it. But the one that I had to watch when I was a kid, like the street gang movie that I had to watch, was Streets of Fire. If you guys recall that movie. More of like a pop song, you know, type thing. It did have Diane Lane in it. And boy, I was a big, tell you what, back then, I called that shit a mile away. I'm like, this girl is going to be famous. This Diane Lane character. Yeah. But that's, you know, I didn't really get to watch about, I didn't get to watch often, but I definitely got to watch Streets of Fire. Okay. Eisner was all about socially conscious, politically active content. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, just saying. Like, that's not a new thing. Like, they hear him talk about comic books now and go, oh, yeah, this is brand new. It's a book. No, it's not. The only difference is, honestly, the standards dropped. The standards dropped. And so because the standards dropped and people aren't as interested and sales aren't doing as well, it becomes an argument about whether or not, you know, diversity and inclusion is the thing, when ultimately it's about a failing product that, like, you need to, you know, Ben and Jerry's make socially conscious ice cream, but if they put shit in their ice cream, you wouldn't eat it. Is what I'm saying. Okay? You could be as socially conscious as you like, but if the ice cream tastes like shit, you will not eat it. End of discussion. All right. Oh, he's still wet there. What's up, Greenleaf Terrain? Adam? Ricky Martin. I don't even know what that, where that comic was. I don't understand. I don't understand. Just trying to dry Ludo off here. It's just about dry. Bill Paxton was in Streets of Fire. That's right. Who else was in Streets of Fire? Willem Dafoe was in Streets of Fire. Remember that? I got guns. Lots of guns. Everyone remember that? You guys? Okay. There's like old people watching this. We're all old. It's okay. We can talk about that. It's fine. It's fine. All right. Let's get another color on Ludo here. Let's get him like that light brown, that orangutan color. Rick Moranis, not Ricky Martin. Yeah, I'm pretty sure Ricky Martin wasn't even in Menudo when Streets of Fire came out. I'm on that semi-old line. I guess that's better than being on the old line. Although, I will tell you, I like being an old dude because I can talk some serious trash about stuff and people are like, whatever. He's just an old cranky dude and hanging me down with that. Especially online, it's better if I do it because like in real life, I actually look really young. So kind of kills the illusion a little bit. Huh? That's me bragging. Anyway. It's going on too thin. I need a, let's mix a little bit of, I'm eating pretzels. Talk to me, tell me your name. That was amazing. The Ricky Martin reference. But of course, if you just read that the way I read that, you're thinking William Hung, right? You guys remember Hung for the Holidays? Talk to me. Tell me your name. That's amazing. Oh, man. I love it. That's super funny. Is that too orange for Ludo? I mean, bear in mind, I'm going to have to wash back down to get to the final tone of the model. So I do want to be a little bit higher. I want to be a little bit lighter color than I should be. I should actually shade him with a red. Okay. So there's that. Yeah, I still get carded for booze and smokes. Wow. If you get carded for smokes, holy crap, you must look young. I actually get pretty happy when I get carded for booze, but I don't get carded for booze anymore because I don't look as young as I'm claiming right now. Getting some salt and pepper in my hair, you know. So it looks somewhat old. I could shave my facial hair off and try to look a little bit younger, but I don't think it'll be that much younger. Okay. I want like an off-white. Should I get not do an off-white? Yeah, I should, huh? Like a really light color. Like lighter than light. Well, that might work. That might actually work. Let's try it. Talk to me, tell me your name. That's super funny. So I sing, just so you know, I sing that song a little differently than it's supposed to be sung because of William Hung specifically. So I go, talk to me, tell me. I like sing it like William Hung sings it because it's funny to me. But I sing, talk to me, tell me your name. I got more dong than the crying game. Because that's funnier. It's just a funnier way of singing that song. Oh, man. All right. Yeah. This is what happens. We don't have a controlled topic. I'm just gonna talk shit like that. It's gonna be bad. But come on, that is kind of funny, right? I got more dong than the crying game. That is kind of funny. Free. I sing it that way to my wife. She thinks it's amazing. Seeing that. Oh, man. See, there's another thing. Like the young people aren't gonna get that reference. I'm like, the crying game, what? The crying game. They won't even know what the hell we're talking about. You remember the controversy when that movie came out? Holy crap. That was a pretty controversial movie. And that wasn't Crying Game's got to be over like 20 years old, right? It's an old movie. But that took on a really progressive topic. Like, that movie is relevant today. But see, we're making it relevant because we're referring to it. William Hung. So the William Hung reference is a good 10 years old, right? Is that, or like, how long has it been since there was a since William Hung was a thing? Only a thing for like 2 years. We can also talk about Shen Yun because I watched Shen Yun this past weekend, and I was actually gonna write, like, on Facebook, I was gonna write my what I was calling crude and unfiltered random thoughts about Shen Yun because it was an okay show. It was Shen Yun was okay. It's not as cool as we were hoping it would be. And I think part of the reason why we were a little bit disappointed is, we were kind of looking at it from a Cirque du Soleil standpoint. And in Cirque du Soleil, I'm just going to give him, I don't care. I'm going to give him a little spritza here. In Cirque du Soleil, when they have like Chinese acts on, they would go, it would be heavily focused on the acrobatics and the precision, like, the yo-yo dancers and all that other stuff that you might get watching Cirque du Soleil. Shen Yun was a lot more like traditional Chinese folk dancing, but it had a lot of that really cool, acrobatics and athleticism. It was still, in my opinion, if you're a person that enjoys going to stuff like Cirque du Soleil, then it's cool and you might want to go. I think if I had the choice, like if like I could go watch, Zumanity, or I could watch Shen Yun, I would go watch Zumanity. But if it was a choice between Shen Yun and, say, River Dance, then for sure picking Shen Yun. So, I guess that's what I'm saying. Better than Riverdance, not as good as Cirque. Okay, almost 8 or 9 years, maybe longer. Okay. Now there's, we're done with the airbrush stuff, so we're just gonna let this dry for a little bit. Man. Yeah. So, yeah. Can I do, I can do like share screen, huh? On this. Yeah, I can screen share. So we can look at, let's look at some Labyrinth stuff together. If I, let's just look at some oops. I hate when I'm typing on keyboards in front of me and, oops, Labyrinth. Okay. So let's look at images of Labyrinth. Since, I mean, the painting stuff is mostly over. Let's say application window. So I just do, was that sharing now? Let's see. Let's look at some Labyrinth stuff. Looking at images of Labyrinth. Looks like it is sharing. Okay, so you can see, like, if you look at Ludo, he's almost like an orangutan, right? He's got oranges and browns. The horns are dark. He's got, like, a real muddy, leathery flesh. So, like, gray-greens and muddier browns. Kind of got dead eyes. That's kind of blows. And then you got Sarah here, and she's got like a cream colored shirt on, and then she has this vest that has a crazy like little pattern in it. And I don't know if I'm going to do that pattern. That pattern looks crazy. I'll figure it out. And then you can see Sir Didymus. He has, you know, it's basically sheepdog. So that part, that's going to end up being white, black nose. You don't paint the eyes on the sheepdog. You paint like some raccoon eyes here on Sir Didymus. I don't know how ever, like, we were all okay with this in the 80s. I don't understand. Like, we were like, oh, yeah, you know, David Bowie was like pushing 50 or something at the time. And, you know, actually, no, he wasn't that old, But Jacob was definitely like underage, but I guess like we were, for whatever reason, like we were okay with that. Labyrinth, that's a cool shot. Okay, that, yeah. Then they had this ball. Actually, this is one of the coolest cosplay things that I've seen. Is usually when you see this cosplay done, it's usually two girls doing the cosplay, and it's amazing. More Labyrinth, more Goblin King. What I'm trying to find is his cloak. I'm trying to find what his cloak looks like from the back. So he has like the cream, like riding pants and all that kind of stuff. And there's the goblins. Let me see. Let's look at, see, there's, let's see if we can find specific images of Jareth. So if I go Labyrinth and the characters, and let's look at Jareth. Okay. So we got to pick like what his outfit will be. Gonna be funny to do like the guy liner and all that stuff. I wish the model, the hair of the model, was a little bigger, floofier, but they did an okay job. You don't get to see the back of his cloak much, do you? He's got looks like, okay, so that's actually the outfit that we're going for right there. He's got this cream undershirt, and then he has, I don't even know what, like reds and maybe purples. Let me go back. Yeah, like that's actually the suit there. And so it's kind of gray riding pants, like red leather overcoat. I see. And that's actually a pretty good shot of Hoggle too. Hoggle's outfit. You don't really get that. Yeah, you never get to see the bones on the back of his some fan art. See, that is some decent cosplay. Now, when he's like twirling the crystal balls, I always like wanted to do that. I always wanted to like, oh man, I wonder how he does that. That's like would be the coolest thing in life to be able to like swirl that little ball in your hand that way. Okay. Anyway, let's go. Let's look at. Yeah, I think I've got. Where's Sir Didymus? Ambrosius. So if I go Ambrosius and Sir Didymus, the Blue Jack was always my favorite look. Yeah. Here we go. Here's a good shot of. So Sir Didymus, his outfit is really blue hat, red, kind of red and yellow vest there. Okay. Okay. Didn't seem too bad. I think that's it. This looks like a very different Sarah character. Some good shots of Ludo. Yeah. Basically just an orangutan. That's all you're really painting. It's really kind of beady dead eyes when it comes down to it. Like if you look at his eyes, it's pretty wild. All right. Anyway, let's and yeah. So I am not going to take any brushes to these tonight because they are that kind of plastic that I'm worried about may bounce. So I'm going to give the paint a full night to cure before I actually start painting. Then I'll paint all the skin on essentially these three characters, the three humanoid characters. And then we'll go from there. So again, apologize, this is a short stream, but that's all I really have for tonight. I'm not going to start another project while these are going, but this should be fun. I mean, now that they've got some color to them, I'm starting to believe in the concept of, yeah, we'll be able to get good-looking miniatures out of these. I don't know if I can pull off a convincing Jennifer Connelly face, but we'll see what we can do. All right. So with that, that's going to do it for this episode. Want to thank everybody for watching. And, you know, I'll kick the camera on in a night or two, just so we can continue to follow up on the project, okay? So with that said, thanks everybody for watching. Have a good night, guys, and we'll catch you on the next one.